So, while the light failed on a winter's afternoon in a secluded chapel, history is now and England. Tonight we're celebrating history. It is a rare and privileged occasion when you can say that each of your readers in the first half are linked genealogically, educationally. Joy taught Tim, Tim taught Miles. In doing that, in the Joy taught Tim, in 1946, they established a formidable line in 20th century history. They tell a tale of knowledge transferred. And during the course of this evening, we're going to go back to 1946 and look at one of the strands of the many that were embarked on to rebuild Europe after it was destroyed through two wars. We're going to do that through the story of one man who took part in two seminal events in this period. In 1945-46, he was a prosecutor of Nuremberg war crimes trials, and subsequently he was a champion and one of those who drafted the European Convention of Human Rights. His name was David Maxwell Fyfe, and in the first half we're going to explore a little of his history and what might have inspired his passion to embark on creating a living law to keep Europe safe, and at the same time, what makes us become passionate, what history is within us that makes us different. Our history is composed of studying history, the ancient history, the classics, looking back as he did to natural law, described by Hollis, looking back to events like Magna Carta, where the tyranny of King John made the development of something else necessary, which was then repeated 14 times over 200 years to maintain the freedoms that they had preserved. You study history, his personal history. Maxwell Fyfe was a Scot. He himself came from Edinburgh, but his mother, a huge influence in his life, came from Sutherland, right up near Dornoch. And we will relay the story of how her uncle committed suicide on the day that he was evicted in the late clearance of Skibo. So you study history, you have your personal history. And perhaps most overwhelming was the immediate history, that from the time that he was a 14-year-old boy to the time that he was a 45-year-old man, the background of his life was war and depression. And in the second half, we'll look at his response to that. But we thought it would be useful to establish the studying, the personal history, and the immediate history in this first half. History is now and England.
To Fuscus, who in city sports delights, a country bard with gentle greeting writes. In this we differ, but in all beside, like twin-born brothers, are our souls allied. And as a pair of fondly constant doves, what one dislikes, the other disapproves. You guard the nest, I praise the rural mead, the brook, the mossy rock, the wooded glade. In short, I live and reign whene'er I fly what you acclaim with rapture to the sky. And yet, you nurture trees and grassy glades amongst the marble art of colonnades, and praise the house whose situation yields an open prospect to the distant fields. drive nature off with a pitchfork, she'll press back and burst in secret triumph through your sad disdain.
Thank you. for my own part, my lord, I could be well contented to be there in respect of a love I bear your house. Could be contented? Why is he not, then? In respect of the love he bears our house, he shows in this he loves his own barn better than he loves our house. Let me see more. The purpose you undertake is dangerous. Why, that's certain. It is dangerous to take a cold, to sleep, to drink. But I tell you, my lord fool, out of this little danger we pluck this flower safety. The purpose you undertake is dangerous, the friends you have named uncertain, the time itself unsorted, and your whole plot too light for the counterpoise of so great an opposition. Ah, say you so, say you so! I say unto you again, you are a shallow cowardly hind, and you lie. What a lack brain is this! By the lord, our plot is a good plot as ever was laid, our friends true and constant. A good plot, good friends and full of expectation. An excellent plot, very good friends. What a frosty-spirited rogue is this!
Bridge, Sutherland, 9th of October, 1883. A.S. Black, Commission Agent, Bonner Bridge, examined. The Chairman. You have a statement to read? I may state I have a letter from Mr. Hugh Campbell, teacher, at the Grammar School, enclosing a paper for the commissioners and asking me to read it. I have been elected a delegate for Creek, as I am the executor of the late Donald Fraser, farmer and miller at Middale, whose ancestors had occupied the farm of Milton for many generations, and who was evicted under exceptionally painful circumstances in 1877. Like many more of the Creek Crofters, the Frasers hailed from Easter Ross. In 1785, the late John Fraser, on his return from the American War where he had served, took by valuation the mills and lands of Milton of Middale, the croft attaching to the mill at that time consisting of a few patches of arable land and about 50 acres of wasteland. In the following year, the estate of Skebo was purchased by the late distinguished agriculturalist George Dempster. The crofters were encouraged to build good houses and fences. If they made good efforts to improve their holdings, a most satisfactory form of tenure was granted to them. The result of this was that a number of the Meekdale tenants, led by John Fraser of Milton, succeeded in obtaining in 1798 a perpetual lease of their holdings. The original tack is in my possession. It granted perpetual tenure. These liberal and enlightened terms were granted in 1798. In 1802, George Dempster sold Skibo to his brother, who entailed the estate and died soon after. He was succeeded by his daughter, Harriet Dempster, who had married Mr. William Soper of the East India Company's service. Mr. Soper assumed the name of Dempster and undertook the management of his wife's estate, but he adopted a different policy from George Dempster. John Fraser of Milton died in 1810 and was succeeded in terms of the tack or lease by his son Hugh Fraser, who occupied the farm until his death in 1876. During his occupancy, the farm was greatly improved, but the policy of the estate officials was now to reverse the liberal policy of George Dempster. In 1818, Mr. Soper Dempster wrote to Hugh Fraser, offering meliorations for all buildings made during his lifetime, and in the event of his being removed from the farm. Hugh Fraser was then lured into renouncing his perpetual tenure for a life tenure, and renouncing his claims on account of stone fences and trees, though a special promise had been given as early as 1804 that compensation for these would be given. The bait took, though the dreadful consequences were not to follow until 60 years had elapsed.
Hush, hush, time to be sleeping.
Promises on his part, and while their tenants were bound by their engagements, the Dempster family declined to be bound by the engagements of William Soper Dempster, as he was not the owner of the estate. The result was that the splendid tack of 1798 became a dead letter, while Hugh Fraser and his son Donald Fraser went on improving the farm in the belief, natural in the circumstances, that they were in possession of perpetual tenure. When Hugh Fraser died in 1876, altogether the improvements were worth £1,500, but Mr. Walker of Skibo, who had acquired the estate by purchase in 1872, declined to pay meliorations and raised an action of removing against Donald Fraser, the heir at law.
Be sleeping, hush.
decided the fate of Fraser. Decree of removal was obtained to take effect on the 15th of October 1877. The shock was so great, and the idea of removing so unexpected, that Fraser's health gave way, and he died, broken-hearted, on the 14th of October 1877, the day before he should have had to remove from the home of his fathers. I hold that it is monstrous that in our country there should exist a system of land laws whereby such a chain of events as those narrated could be at all possible.
Those long, uneven lines, standing as patiently as if they were stretched outside the oval or villa park. The crowns of hats, the sun on moustached archaic faces, grinning as if it were all an August bank holiday lark. And the shut shops, the bleached established names on the sun blinds, the farthings and sovereigns and dark-clothed children at play called after kings and queens, the tin advertisements for cocoa and twist, and the pubs, wide open, all day. And the countryside not caring, the place names all hazed over with flowering grasses and fields shadowing doomsday lines under wheat's restless silence, the differently dressed servants with tiny rooms in huge houses, the dust behind limousines. Never such innocence. Never before or since has changed itself to pass without a word. The men leaving the gardens tidy. The thousands of marriages lasting a little while longer. Never such innocence.
Yeah.
if I should die, think only this of me, that there's some corner of a foreign field that is forever England. There shall be in that rich earth a richer dust concealed, a dust whom England bore, shaped, made aware, gave once her flowers to love, her ways to roam. A body of England's, breathing English air, washed by the rivers, blessed by the suns of home. And think, this heart, all evil shed away, a pulse in the eternal mind, no less gives somewhere back the thoughts by England given, her sights and sounds, dreams happy as her day, and laughter learnt of friends, and gentleness in hearts at peace under an English heaven.
Indifferent, flippant, earnest, but all bored, the doctors sit in the glare of electric light, watching the endless stream of naked white bodies of men for whom their hasty award means life